your children and don't let them fall by the side of the road. And teach them to love one another, that heaven might find a place in their hearts. 'Cause Jesus, and I know He is mine forever. Is it my heart?
So you all are doing a lot in the community. Now you shared with me in the green room something interesting. You said, Shana, I want to take the concept of God. He is real, but He's going to meet people where they are, even if that means the marketplace, meaning the job market. Now, that's something we don't hear a lot about. Explain, Pastor.
Yes, definitely. Well, I'm glad that you're touching on that, because I think that's a very important aspect of the outreach now. Yes. In the end time. It has to do with the marketplace, and the business community is really where the church should be focusing its outreach
Jill
in the profession.
She ended up creating a very good relationship with Mrs. B, who actually was the first female millionaire out of Omaha, Nebraska in the 60s. And she was in the Jewish community. Matter of fact, Warren Buffett was a great friend of hers.
Really?
And matter of fact, she started Nebraska Furniture Mart, and Warren ended up purchasing that, you know, that particular, the Nebraska Furniture Mart. But she ended up funding my mom, and also my mother felt compelled after Dr. King was assassinated in 1968, she felt compelled to go to Atlanta.
Something particular to say about the need for religious liberty that perhaps we need to hear today? I know that you and I have spoken about this, this topic before. Did you want to say anything about what Bishop Mason and the Kojic might say about religious liberty today?
Yeah, well, you know, it goes back to, I mean, Kojic has a long history of religious liberty going back to Bishop Mason, because he believed that the government of heaven was his true government, not really the government of this earth, you know, because he conflicted with it in that sense. But he was correct, you know, because, and he believed in Pentecostal, and he believed in what Seymour and what the move of God had established initially, that it was for all God's people to worship together, just like in Revelations, when you see every people, tongue, and creed. When you see him in heaven, there's no separation of race, there's no separation of this. So he said, well, this is God's will.
My next guest is Prophet
Elijah.
Elijah Hill. And he has a project has to do with you. Tell us more about that.
Well, certainly, Bishop Shield, it's such an honor to be here on the show with you.
Thank you.
And to have me here to just share with Atlanta. I'm from Arlington, Texas.
Okay.
And we're going to be relocating here to Atlanta. But what we're really, God has put a mandate on our heart concerning the youth, you know, of Atlanta. And basically, that vision is really not just Atlanta alone, but it's really throughout the world.
Okay. Morning is take someone by the hand and repeat after me the title. The title is Remembering the First, Glory. Say that again. Remembering the First, Glory. There is a glory in retrospect to God's majesty when it comes to the creation of the Lord. That's one derivative of the keel. Number two, there is another glory, the nature of the acts of God's miracles. There's a glory surrounding the nature of a miracle being created. Praise the Lord. It's something that's out of the extraordinary. It's supernatural. It's not natural. It's not normal. But the unnaturalness of a miracle is the display of God's glory.
All right. The title is Placing It in the Master's Hand. Say that again. Placing it in the Master's hand. That's what the hand is for. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And the prophet said, bring me a morsel of bread in thine hand. In other words, I need your hand. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And the Hebrew word for the word hand is, it's used, it's called chair, is the word hand. That's just the Hebrew translation, chair. But we're going to look at three derivative translations. Number one, chair means hand. Number two, there's another word in the Hebrew that says auto chair. Now, auto chair means made with your own hands. In other words, it's something you got to do with your hand. That's auto chair. That means you. That's why he said, do it with your, go get me a piece of bread with thine hand. That's auto chair. And then the other one is a potus chair, which means made without human hands. Praise the Lord. Made without human hands.
Take someone by the hand and repeat after me and say, the four things that God seeks after. Say that again. The four things that God seeks after.
Hallelujah. And if you look at this particular verse, beloved, it goes on to say, and those that seek me early shall find me. Hallelujah. Those that seek me early shall find me. Praise the Lord. So it says, I love them that love me. In other words, if you look at the understanding of the word of God, how is it that God says, I love them that love me? When God is love, God loves everybody. All creation is God's. But yet in this particular scripture, God speaks to us prophetically and he opens up his heart and he says, I love them that love me. In other words, there's another partition. There's another part that you're leaving out. See, when we love God, sometimes we love God from a one-sided direction. Lord, as long as you give me what I need. Lord, as long as you provide for me what I need. Lord, if I'm in trouble, I want you to be there. But in this particular scripture, beloved, God reveals his heart. He said, but I love them that love me. Hallelujah. In other words, God desires for us to come into relationship with him.
Honored to introduce Elder Elijah Hill. He's a Church of God in Christ minister in Arlington, Texas, originally from Omaha, Nebraska. And he is an evangelist, a teacher, and he's a good brother in Christ. Would you please come here?
I'm going to ask you to go ahead and come right around here. And we want to have you just sort of share your heart a little bit, and then Darren and I would like to chat with you. How's that sound?
Yeah. Well, I'm just, you know, anything specific you want me to?
Well, Darren, right. Why don't you come on, join me, please, because we want you on camera. Okay.
Yeah.
And we're just going to be, we want to have a conversation. So let me have you, you get the first question, because I've got five. So, but you get the first question, because just to help you, this for those of you watching on the video that's being made, and for all of us here, this is World Christianity 2.
All right.
So we have been studying from the 16th century to the current day, and we're stepping into the 20th century. So we've been learning about the evangelical roots to the global Pentecostal movement, and in fact, I'll be teaching about the late 19th, early 20th century, starting this evening after they endure an exam. So you get to help delay the exam a little bit right now.
But see there?
See, they're either saying amen or oh my.
That's a good thing.
But I think so. That's our context, is that we're studying history together. And
wasn't he accused by the government or by some people of being a German spy?
Certainly, yeah. Yeah, they did that too, because also. So the FBI trumped up an argument that, you know, well, this guy is, he's supporting, you know, Germany, basically. Now, the reason how they utilize that is Mason also was a multicultural interracialist, where he had people that were white that were under his African-American organization.
That's right.
That were bishops and overseers and stuff like that. Now, remember, like I said about Plessy versus Ferguson, this is against the law, but he does it anyway because of Azusa and what he's been seeing through the years. He just, no, this is God's will, you know? So he does it despite the law. Some people are being lynched for it. Some people are being killed every day for it. He does it anyway. He goes as far as, I found out in the FBI files, that he creates a law called the Equal Right of Authority. And in his manual, he says, within, it's just a constitution.
So
within,
he created a law, like a bylaw within his organization.
Mm-hmm. It's called the Equal Right of Authority. And he says that because in America, when a white bishop, you know, you don't want to have blacks serving over whites and this administratively. So what he does is, he says that within our organization, we're going to do this, where a white man can be over white, vice versa. So is he not political? Here, Plessy versus Ferguson, he's contradicting even what America is doing. So I see it as him institutionalizing what's happening in Azusa and taking it to another level.
So this equal right of authority, it said that it didn't matter if you were black or white, you would be an authority regardless of race.
Right.
And see
Mason's, his secretary, his general secretary was white, William Holt, of his national organization. And so he had German descent. So what the FBI did, they found that out and said, oh, see, he's helping the Germans because he's integrating these whites and blacks. He's talking about they can't go to war. So they trump up this conspiracy and try to try Mason for treason against the United States.
I'll give you the first question, and then I've got several.
Very good. Well, Elder Hill, you first got interested in Church of God in Christ history in a significant way when you, I believe, discovered the collection of Lizzie Robinson. Was that right?
Certainly.
Could you tell us more about your growing interest in Lizzie Robinson?
Yeah. Kind of my pathway, you know, started with history, mainly under our local organization. And our presiding bishop of probably four presiding bishops back. I think you talked about the Patterson collection, but Patterson succeeded Mason, basically, and then Bishop Ford came to Omaha, to our hometown, and held a press conference in 1990, and he had all these people from all over at the press conference, and he said, well, Omaha can do more to help us with our history than any city in America. And all of us Omahans were saying, how's that? Right in the middle of the United States. We don't have nothing here, you know. And that's kind of what our attitude was. But then he began to talk about Lizzie Robinson, her being the first women's department organizer in 1911, and how she lived in Omaha for 30-something years, and how he used to come and visit her. And she was just so key to Bishop Mason's organization of Church of God in Christ. And so we were just shocked when he began to delve in how important she was, because she had died in 1945. So we had this press conference almost, you know, 50 years later. So some of the history was kind of far removed from us. So my bishop said, well, Elder Hill, can you do some research? Because we were kind of far removed from the history. Like, what? Okay. So we began to really delve into it and research her history and found out how significant she was as a humanitarian. So what ended up happening, I did a research on her life, and I began to dig up a lot of documents and things that proved where she was and her being there. And we ended up getting her and her husband start the first Church of God in Christ in Omaha, Nebraska in 1916. And I ended up getting that church put on the local landmark, Heritage Preservation Commission, to preserve it. And then the next step was I ended up writing a federal nomination to show her significance, not so much with religion, but from the angle of a humanitarian and how she worked with women and women development and, you know, economic development. Yeah, I kind of came from that angle to the secular world, and boy, they just loved it. Whoa, we didn't know. And she had global reach, and she sent missionaries all over the world from Omaha, and she raised all the money to supply this global ministry. And I ended up finding out, and this is just the State Historical Society, they were so flabbergasted, that she actually was the one that came to Bishop Mason about extending Kojic beyond the shores of the United States. And she came up with the concept. And so he said, well, he was so confident in her work, he said, well, okay, we can do it, but it's for you to do it. So the women handle missions, even as large as we are with missions, but the women handle missions for years. And they funded it, they supported it, and so they sent women all over the world. China, Africa, you know, the islands, you know, we populated that and what have you. And the women, they built churches, they built clinics and dormitories and just all kinds of things. And so she held a very, very significant role, you know, in the church. And that's kind of where my journey started evolving from there. I ended up getting a street named after her in Nebraska, 1992. The community was just flabbergasted. They said, well, she's almost comparable to Father Flanagan when it comes to humanitarian works. You know, we didn't know we had a person in our midst like that. So they just really embraced it. They ended up giving her a street name, actually, in Nebraska. The first woman to get a street name.
I want to welcome you this afternoon. My name is Byron Klaus. For those of you who are our guests here at AGTS, I'm the president here. And I am very glad and honored to honor a very special person today, Mother Lizzie Robinson. Today also Reverend Elijah Hill, who's been with us here at AGTS a number of times, author and historian, who has deposited Mother Robinson's personal papers at the Flower Heritage Center. He's written a biography on Mother Robinson, and he will share about her life and legacy. It will also culminate in the dedication of the Robinson Hill collection of papers. This is a very large and important collection of Church of God in Christ materials. I want to point out today that, and I point out regularly to first-time guests and on a regular basis, we are in the William Seymour Chapel. Behind me in this stained glass right here, Brother Seymour is watching over all of our proceedings today. And I often remind people that Brother Seymour would be amazed that anybody would be remembering him 100 years after the fact. But this man greatly used of God, we honor today as we honor Mother Robinson. Bishop Seymour led an interracial revival, Azusa Street in Los Angeles, beginning in April 1906. And both of our churches, the Church of God in Christ and the Assemblies of God, are heirs to that particular revival. So to begin our time today, I want to introduce Darren Rogers, who's been going to MC the program. He is a director of the Flower Pentecostal Heritage Center and an alum of AGTS. Let's welcome Darren.
Thank you, Dr. Klaus. It's an honor to be here. This is an exciting day. But rather, Elder Hill has also seen fit to continue that vision to preserve our sacred stories and to build these bridges across the very various divides that sometimes seem to keep us apart. So thank you, Elder Hill. But we're dedicating the collection today of the most famous church mother in the Church of God in Christ, and this collection contains a wealth of information and photos, in particular about women in the Church of God in Christ who helped to build the church. So I would like to extend a warm welcome to our friends from the Church of God in Christ today. And as I introduce you, please stand up so we can recognize you. Reverend Elijah Hill. It's my pleasure to introduce Elder Elijah L. Hill. If you'd like to join me up here, Elder Hill. Elder Hill is a Church of God in Christ minister, a historian, author, educator, and cultural anthropologist. You've authored a number of books, and you've traveled extensively. Sorry. And in addition to preaching, you speak on Church of God in Christ history, mm-hmm. and you also you hold an MBA and a master's degree in educational technology, and you're currently working on your doctorate in education in organizational leadership.
That's right.
Thank you very much, Elder Hill. You and I have been speaking for a number of years here also, mm-hmm. and I'm just thrilled that the collection that you've had in your possession that you've taken good care of. I'm thrilled that you've entrusted that to us now. So thank you.
Thank you.
And I look forward to hearing about the life and legacy of Lizzie Robinson.
Amen. Thank you very much, Darren. Thank you very much, Darren. And I appreciate the Flower Heritage Pentecostal Center, and also appreciate Dr. Klaus for, you know, allowing us to celebrate this momentous occasion. And just wanted to say that it's a little hard having held on to this collection for 25 years in my personal collection to let it go. But I know it's going to be in good hands. And just want to honor. Here stood an African-American woman where God had a plan for her life from the time she was 8 years old, reading the Bible to slaves that could not read, to become one of the greatest organizers among Christian women as an African-American Pentecostal by her death in 1945 at the age of 84 years old at the world headquarters of the Church of God in Christ in Memphis, Tennessee. Her life story speaks, is a monument actually left for all women, that it does not matter what circumstances that befall you, if you look to God as your source, it is never too late to complete the work of the Lord Jesus Christ that is upon your life. Hello, here we are again today with another segment of the Watchman's Wall. Just had a word for you before you go out to work today. That you were conceived in the imagination of God. If we look at that in the scripture in Jeremiah 1 and 5, it says, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee." The Hebrew word yada, it means to know by acquaintance. In other words, God knew you in his imagination. You were an idea conceived in heaven first before you were downloaded into your mother's womb. So this morning as you go out, I want you to just know that you're in God's memory files, your purpose and your destiny. And God defined Jeremiah before he was even in the womb experience. In other words, God was acquainted with him. So God's acquainted with you. Your purpose has been sealed in the Lord. And we need to know that whatever things come into your life to corrupt, you know, those things that God, the disappointments, the hurts, abuse, the misuse, but you were designed to survive. God made you to survive.